We've had hundreds of note verbals already issued. There have been suggestions from lawmakers to actually recall the ambassadors of each country. Change the Chinese ambassador, send the Philippine ambassador home. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, we can recall our ambassador to Beijing. That's one of the steps we can do to show our displeasure, our protest. But it's up to Beijing to recall their ambassador. Normally, if we recall our ambassador, they will also recall their ambassador. But we have to calibrate this. We cannot be expelling the Chinese ambassador right away. We should expel lower officials in their embassy and calibrate it, escalate it upwards, because it's very extreme sanction if you expel the ambassador.
Yeah. So, doesn't this downgrade our diplomatic ties?
Well, it will. It will, in effect, downgrade our diplomatic ties, because the embassy will be run by the Sharjah, on both ends. But those are one of the options we can take. But for me, the tribunal would be the more effective one. And sending our survey ship together with a joint patrol with the U.S. would be the most effective way of getting the gas in Reed Bank.
Okay. Now, what about ASEAN? ASEAN has been so silent on China's actions.
Well, the problem with ASEAN is that they have a consensus rule. Everybody must agree. Otherwise, there's no agreement. And of course, when it comes to China, Cambodia, Laos, and Myanmar will always be supporting. They are the proxies of China. So we can never get a consensus from ASEAN on our dispute with China. So what we should do is just I call this the coalition of the willing. The countries prejudiced by the nine dash line should just join forces. Vietnam, Malaysia, Philippines, Indonesia, and Brunei should form their own bloc within ASEAN and deal with China on that basis.
Okay. Now, what about, so you don't have a lot of expectations with ASEAN. The code of conduct. I remember during the time of former President Duterte, when Senator Alan Cayetano was with the DFA, he said there were high level groups from China and the Philippines that were bent to close the code of conduct. Where are we now when it comes to that?
Well, we are still back to square one because, first of all, there is no agreement on the scope. Vietnam wants to include the Paracels. China doesn't want to include the Paracels. We want to include Scarborough Shoal. China doesn't want to include Scarborough Shoal. We want the arbitral award to be included. China doesn't want that. So practically, there has been no movement.
Yeah.
And China said, we will sign the code of conduct at the appropriate time. When is the appropriate time? I think the appropriate time for China is when China's finished its air and naval bases building.
Yes. Yeah. We have with us again, former Supreme Court Associate Justice Antonio Carpio. So we were talking about the code of conduct, why that didn't, why it fell through. So Vietnam wanted to include the Paracels. And China didn't want to include Scarborough, the arbitral ruling, etc. So in other words, no agreement, right? So are you still hopeful that the code, that there is a chance for a code of conduct to push through in ASEAN or to be formed?
Well, I'm very skeptical about the code of conduct because the code of conduct will simply be used by China to legitimize its island building, to legitimize the air and naval bases that it has established and will establish. Because after China puts up an air and naval base on Scarborough Shoal, China will say, okay, let's sign the code of conduct. From now on, nobody builds anything. And if you do that, then you have legitimized what has been built before that. And that's why we want to put there the arbitral award. And of course, China will not agree to that because the arbitral award will mean that there is no 9 or 10 dash line. I have no hope at all that a code of conduct will materialize. But it's good to talk, to use it as a forum just to discuss. But we should not put our hopes and energy, too much energy, on the code of conduct.
Okay. I'm curious at this, moment, Justice, what area, where is China building at this point?
Well, China's finished building in the Spratlys. Of course, in the Paracels, they have built in several areas, and the biggest there is Woody Island. There, they have to build on Scarborough Shoal. Remember, in the G20
and right
meeting.
Now, so I'm curious. Right now, our nations, our stakeholder nations, at the very least, preventing them building. Or are you seeing movement in Scarborough Shoal for construction?
Well, the Americans have said that that's a red line. We have said that's a red line. And so far, the Chinese have not made any move. The last time that they tried to send dredgers was during the G20 meeting in Hangzhou. That's during the last year of the Obama administration. But they have not done it again. But you can see that they had that intention, and it's just a matter of time before they resume. So we have to be prepared for that.
Okay. All right. Now, what is your take? I mean, with this administration, President Marcos's statements and gestures when it comes to China and the West Philippine Sea?
Well, as I said, I was pleasantly surprised that President Marcos Jr. has adopted this policy of asserting the arbitral award, not giving up a single inch of Philippine territory in the West Philippine Sea, strengthening our alliances with the U.S. and other like-minded states. But the acid test, the litmus test, will be: can we get the gas in Reed Bank? Mm-hmm. That is really the litmus test, because mm-hmm. it will all go down to that. Our neighbors have succeeded. Malaysia, they were able to survey and drill in their EEZ despite threats of war by China. Indonesia was able to do it also. It's our turn. We have to do it, because it will devastate our economy if we fail to do it.
Okay. I'm curious at this point, who should take the lead when it comes to recommending this to the president?
Well, I think they are discussing it already, because with respect to surveying and drilling in Reed Bank, the preparation is there. We have already started our joint patrol with the U.S., and there will be a series of this. I think it will end up in Reed Bank. So I expect that to happen soon, because we're running out of time. It takes 4 years to develop Reed Bank, and Malampaya is running out of gas already. It used to supply our three largest gas-fired plants. Now it's supplying only two, and maybe at the end of this year, only one. So we really have to make a move now.
Yeah, that's very good that you said that, because what's interesting is, if you're President Marcos Jr., that's the litmus test. Our neighbors have done it. He has 6 years in office. Ideally, before he leaves, there should be some development in the Reed Bank under his administration, and it would be his legacy.
That's right, Karen, because if he cannot do that before he leaves office, then he cannot... anyone he anoints will have a hard time in the election. So he will not be able to anoint his successor. And opposition candidate will be pointing to that as a grave failure, as a serious failure on his part, because our neighbors were able to do it. So I think the pressure is on him to do it.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you so much. Supreme Court Associate Justice Antonio Carpio, thank you for joining me, sir.
Thank you, Karen. Thank you to our viewers, too, for listening.